Hello, I'm Carol Williams. All over the world, I play pipe organs for a living.
I love it.
I meet great concert organists.
Now, as I meet them, I'd like you to meet them too.
Here's the bench, and here's me. There's not always a bench.
That's a metaphor.
Here we go.
That's stupid. This is kind of fun. Books. That's what I like talking about. Books. Where's my pencil? Oh. Are we ready, huh?
Yeah.
What do you call this? Is this...
On the bench.
On the bench, that's
all right.
What guys say, off the bench or on
Oh, no, off the bench. No, I haven't got it on...
It's on the
Yeah, because it started as an idea with an organ bench. Well, this is a first. This is the second interview, and today I'm chatting with Gordon Turk, and he's joining me, and I know it will be a great chat on the bench with Dr. Carol. Gordon.
Well, we're on a different bench this time. Yeah. The last time we chatted, we were on the West Coast.
We were on the West Coast. Now we're on the East Coast.
And San Diego. And yes. Now here you are in Ocean Grove.
Yes.
In the venerable auditorium, which is pictured here behind us.
I know.
A 1939 photograph. See all the women wearing hats?
Yes. So I bet that was... That would have been the summer, wouldn't it?
Right. Yes. Because the building is open only in the summer.
Right. So, and it's packed, that picture. I'm just looking at how many people does the auditorium seat?
At this point, 6,700.
Golly,
it used to seat more than that when they had benches in the upper balconies,
right.
And now they have chairs.
So the organ console is where?
It's down behind the center podium.
Right.
And they, things have changed a little bit up here, just a few things have structurally. But the organ console is still there. It's more visible now than it used to be.
Yes.
And it's a bigger console now than
it
used
to
be,
too. Yes, it's a bigger console. And it's a bigger organ, isn't it?
Every
time I come back. I mean, it's just quite a bit is always added every visit.
Yes. Well, we're just about maxed out in terms of space.
Really?
But it... actually, today, I had a call from the pipe factory. It said they're shipping a set of pipes that were built specially for this organ.
Oh.
And a Heckelphone.
Yes.
And so that will be arriving in a few days and will be installed as soon as the pipes arrive.
That's a rare set of pipes, isn't it?
Yes.
So how many are there in the country do you know of?
I know of two, and I understand that there are one or two more. Woolsey Hall at Yale University has one, and the Hill Auditorium Organ in the University of Michigan also has one. I think there may be one in a church somewhere in Brooklyn or somewhere out in St. Louis, but I haven't heard anything about them for a long time. And most people don't even realize that it's an actual orchestral instrument.
Right.
Built by somebody named Mr. Heckel. He was a German, I guess, inventor. I don't know if he was a musician first, an inventor second, or an inventor. But at any rate, he developed this as an instrument which is similar to the English horn, but larger and deeper in tone.
So it's a fairly big sound?
Fairly. But it's not loud like trumpets.
No.
But it's a full, very
like a
full
tuba
sound.
Horn, or trumba,
yes, more like that. Yeah.
So where will it go in the organ?
It will be in the solo division.
Okay.
And there, it's accessible for, particularly for solo lines.
Right.
And like most of the solo stops that we use in the organ, the solos are generally in the tenor to middle alto to soprano treble line. Most of them are we think of immediately as being the treble. But this will have more middle range and lower range.
Sounds so lovely.
I'm anxious for it.
So when do you think it will be in a couple of weeks playing?
We're expecting that the pipes will be arriving within the week. They're actually being shipped today as we speak.
Gosh.
I talked to the company this morning, and they're all ready to go, and they're just waiting for the truck to ship them here. So they may be here in a matter of 3 or 4 days, at which time we will immediately begin the installation.
It'll be like Christmas in July, won't it?
That's exactly right, yes.
So remind our listeners, we're getting quite a lot of listeners to the series, which is great. Remind our listeners when you start here in Ocean Grove and what your work involves.
Okay, it's a summer engagement because the building was built for summer use. It's not insulated, and in the winter it's cold in here, very, very cold, frigid. But in the summer, the season begins the second week of June, and it's a light season for a couple of weeks. Then it all breaks loose. As soon as children are out of school, then more people come down here, because there are lots and lots of families, and it's a big youth program. So things really kick loose the very beginning of July.
Right.
And then it involves Wednesday evening and Saturday noon recitals through all of July and August.
Right.
And some of them are played by guests, and you are our distinguished guest and our friend. You have been here several times, so it's always a treat to have
you
come back.
It's
the people
to come
look
back.
For you on the program.
Thank you.
So they're really glad. And if they don't see your face, they come and knock on my door and say,
"Well,
when is Carol Williams coming back?"
These are nice people.
So, they are. So they enjoy your concerts and your being here, as do I. So that season goes through Labor Day.
Right. And so about how many programs do you play Wednesdays and Saturday afternoons?
I play about 12 to 14.
That's a lot, isn't it? And
yes.
Every program is different?
Every program is different.
Gosh.
And in addition to that, I'm also involved in some of the chamber music programs,
right,
which is different literature. And that is its own thing. And then I oversee the whole series of the chamber music programs. So I'm busy with that as well. And I accompany the Friday night choir rehearsals. And I also play for the Sunday services.
Right.
So there is a lot going on with music. And there is a professional vocal quartet in residence in the summer. And they are great to work with. And so that's another part of the music program. Choral music is a big part of the program here in the summer, and these having wonderful professional solos, there are four of them who are residents for the whole season, is also a treat.
Yeah.
So that is all part of the picture.
So on a Sunday morning service, how many are in the choir?
Usually about 100.
That's
it's a volunteer choir.
Yes.
And people from the area who come here to rehearse for the services here in the summer.
Yes, like they were last night.
Yes.
Right.
When we do special events, such as last night, they were rehearsing for a concert that they're doing in August.
Okay.
There'll be maybe 200 people in the choir for that, and we'll have an orchestra. But when we do our choir festival, which is an annual event, one Sunday night in July, we have 600 to 800 singers.
Yeah.
And they fill the building, the audience, the congregation does. And that's always
exciting.
That must
be amazing. I mean, it's like that.
Yes.
It's packed.
It's like that.
Do you get a good, you know, congregation on a Sunday morning?
Yes.
That's
all things
really
considered.
Good.
Nothing like this picture
anymore.
No,
but I mean.
But yes.
Except when you have a choir festival like that, I'm sure
and then it grows exponentially for that because it's such an exciting event.
So the weather this time is not hugely blue sky and sun. It's a little bit cloudy, a bit English really to me.
Well,
nice rains. Does that affect people coming here to Ocean Grove and to the auditorium?
Oh, certainly it does.
Oh, really?
Because it is a beach town.
Yeah.
And if people know with our radar weather now,
yes,
they know,
that's true.
Oh, it's going to definitely be a bad week or something.
Wow.
Then they may change their plans or stay away. And some will say, well, it was the luck of the draw, and I drew a rainy week, and here I am. So it can work both ways for it.
So How many ranks now is the organ?
When these new pipes arrive,
yes.
It'll be 202 ranks.
Gosh.
So
and
that's,
how many thousands of
so that's
pipes?
Close to 13,000 pipes.
Wow.
It's really large.
It is a large organ. I mean, you think about it, they're tuning the organ this afternoon, which,
yes.
I mean, they, you know, they have, what, 4 or 5 hours. I mean, they're only doing a tiny amount of the organ.
Right.
Because it's impossible, isn't it, to tune an organ 13,000 pipes. It must take days.
13,000.
Yeah,
yes.
13,000.
It takes 3 or 4 days to
yes.
do the whole instrument.
Right.
But they're amazingly versatile and
yes.
adept at what they're doing.
Yes.
And they know how to keep, as they say, keep the pipes happy,
yes.
in a happy place. Oh. So they don't have to be tuned all the time with, they seem
yeah.
to have it in a way that it can ride above, ride the current
yes.
of the temperatures. And the people are always surprised at how good the tuning is when they come to hear the organ
yes.
concert.
I am too. I mean, it's always tight and it's fiery. John Shaw has looked after this organ for years. He
yes.
is a father figure over the
That's
whole
right.
building, isn't he, really, with the organ. I mean, he's
yes.
he has such a brain, a wonderful person, he really is, and he knows so much, and his humor. I mean, he...
yes, he has quite a sense of humor.
Yes.
And he thinks of himself in a way as the kind of successor to Hope Jones, who
really?
Built the organ
yes.
here. And he has a little stool that's in the basement
yes.
down in one of the, he's probably told you about it,
yes.
Down in one of the chambers in which he's quite certain that Hope Jones sat on this little stool.
Yes.
So he keeps that there as Hope Jones' stool.
Yes. Well, we did a tour bus video here
that's
a
right.
number of years ago, and I remember talking about that. I remember him talking about how the organ is closed down during the winter.
Mm-hmm.
And how it comes to life. When, to refresh my memory, when do you literally kick it together, starting?
We start in April,
right.
I think, and start doing things quietly. John will be working on projects even in the winter. He'll be in here
it's
dressed
colder,
up
isn't it?
Like
wow.
Nanook of the North.
Yes.
And keeping with some little heaters and things so that he's able to actually physically move his hands in the cold weather and do some work. And he and some of his associates will work with him on some projects in the winter. But when it starts to warm up naturally,
yeah.
then they can do more. And April is when things start, and May we're really working to get everything.
So when he's working here in the winter and working, is the organ, does he turn the organ on or?
No.
No.
You can't, because the temperature differential between summer and winter is so extreme that the regulators, the reservoirs that store the
yeah.
air, are made of wood and have leather hinges on the sides and gussets on the corners, and these would all split with the if air was forced through them
sure.
in 6 degrees.
Right, 6 degrees.
Well, it gets so cold in here.
I believe it.
So,
there's concrete chambers, right?
Some of them, the original chambers are concrete.
So that affects the way the sound is projected into the auditorium?
Well, it was the brainstorm or the brainchild of Hope Jones who built it, because he wanted to separate different timbres or different sounds of the pipes. The diapason pipes in one chamber, the string pipes in another chamber, the flute pipes in another chamber,
wow.
and what we call the reed pipes
yeah.
in another chamber. But that's, so the core, the center of the organ from the original part is still in those chambers. And it's colder in there, and we tune those last thing for the summer season. We wait, most of the organ we start tuning in June, beginning of June. And we wait until the end of June, the last week, before we start to tune those that are in the concrete chambers, because they are, it takes longer for those chambers to warm up
yeah.
naturally. So,
do you have a favorite sound on the organ? I mean, I was just thinking as you were talking, I love the diapason sounds on this organ.
I do too.
I mean, it's just regal and just beautiful. And with there's a slight acoustics in there. It's not a big acoustics,
mm-hmm.
but you can really let it just let it sing into the building. What is your favorite sound?
I particularly like the diapasons, yes. And we have many, many of them in this organ, and it provides a lot of different opportunities of different types, but they all, and each one enriches the other, it seems. Yes. The strings are very beautiful in this organ. Yes. There's so many of them.
Yeah.
10 times more than you normally find in an average organ.
Absolutely.
And that
takes ages. So I mean, I always feel when I come here, I need a lot of time.
And I'm glad you do.
I mean,
take the time.
I know that from this organ, I think people say, oh, well, you've played it before. You know what you're. I've played it before. I know what I'm in for. I'm in. I have to work hard. That is how I feel with this instrument, just to get a chance to enjoy it. I mean, nowhere have I got near to how you master this instrument by a long way. And, you know, it must have taken many, many years to enjoy everything and make the organ shine.
Well, that's the part of living with it on a kind of day-to-day basis and playing it every day. But one of the things that I enjoy about your being here is that the finest players who come here are those who come and spend a couple of days
you
in preparation.
You just have to.
And no matter how talented and how many places they've performed, they recognize
This is a unique organ.
That this instrument needs...
It's unique.
Yeah. So needs attention.
Besides music, you have a great love of literature.
Oh, yes. I like very interested in books, reading.
Yes.
And I also like books for the beauty that the books have, particularly when they have nice margins, when they're beautifully printed. Sometimes you find in more scholarly texts that you'll find them printed on special paper.
Yes.
And
the smell of a book, isn't it?
It's always nice.
And the tissue paper on the old books for the lovely plates that they have, you know?
And also the liners that are inside are quite often, they have this beautiful variegated look. A lot of the English books and a lot of the Italian books have this beautiful, there's a name for it, I'm trying to remember what that art is, that I've seen it being done in Italy, where they can take paper. I remember seeing it in Venice, in a paper shop, and they will put the colors and the inks and the swirls, and they create this beautiful, beautiful paper that they use for wrapping packages or boxes, and they use for the linings of books on the
Exactly what you mean. Yes, yes.
Yeah.
It's very colorful.
Yes.
Yes, yeah.
And there is a name for it, and I can't think of it. But you find books with beautiful leather bindings.
Oh, I know. Do you have a lot of books?
I have quite a few, but I don't have...
Have you got any many old books?
Most of the old books that I have are... old music books of some sort, and some hymnals that go back to... I have one book of poetry. It has Orlando di Furioso. Di Furioso, that old poem from... The book comes from the 1600s.
Wow.
And it's... The book is about the size of this.
Wow.
But it's four times thicker than this.
So how does it...
Leather-bound.
And you open up...
And you just open...
Wow, the binding on that must be interesting.
Yeah, the printing is very small. And it's in Italian, and it's...
I've got some very old books, like late 1880s, and I'm not sure how they're going to survive here. You know, they came from England, and some of them got the suede covers and the very old paper, and I think they almost need, like, toner like women need, you know, to spray on them. And I think they do that, don't they, in libraries?
They
to keep
do that,
them moist.
They certainly have rooms that have climate control. And I know a few artifacts that I have in terms of letters that I keep in acid-free paper. Mm. One of them was from Albert Schweitzer, the great musician, a scholar of Bach's music, and biographer of Bach, and also theologian and missionary, doctor and philosopher. Mm-hmm.
Studied with Beadle. Hmm? He studied with Beadle, didn't he?
Yes, he did.
Yeah, and he recorded at Sansulpice, didn't he?
I think at Sansulpice.
Yeah.
Interesting enough, for organist conversation, he thought the Cavaille Coles were the ideal organ for the playing of the music of Bach.
Hmm.
And no one will tell you that today.
No.
But he thought there was something about the mixtures and the whole makeup of the organ that made it
ideal. I can understand why the majesty those organs particularly have. And, you know, his music is so majestic. Mm-hmm. Yeah, I can see that.
And that gets lost in the translation of a lot of contemporary understanding.
Yes, lesser and a big acoustics.
They have wonderful acoustics, but the music of Bach was, even in the German buildings, in the German organs, he didn't always have the organ. I don't think he ever had what he considered the ideal instrument for his own organ to play.
No.
He particularly liked the builder, Hildebrand was one of his favorite builders. And his music has such majesty when it's recognized through the composition, the structure of the music, and the sound.
Yeah.
And he had a sense of what it means to play the organ in his soul, in his brain, in his ears.
Yeah.
You know, we may have discussed this before, but I think it was Charles-Marie Vidor who said, you have to have a sense of eternity in order to play the organ.
That's
that was a comment of his. And it's something other than just playing on the keys.
No, it connects you to something greater.
Mm-hmm.
We've been moving and I'm still unpacking stuff, and I finally this week found my lovely engraving of the Trost organ.
In
Altenburg.
Yes.
And I'll put that in a frame. I just love this. I love this engraving.
Have you played it?
I have played it. And I was looking at the specification last night, my bedtime reading, but looking at the specification last night, it was so orchestral because Bach played that organ.
Yes.
I think he might have had a hand in designing the organ. I'm not sure.
I think the organ was really quite old by the time I think it preceded him by a bit, but I know he was very interested in that.
10, 15 years before 1739, 17, I think.
I thought maybe it was even older.
Well, maybe,
than that.
Maybe you're right. But I remember sitting on that bench and thinking, wow, he's sat here too, you know, I mean, and it's exactly as it was, you know. It's an incredible organ. And it looks
I think
beautiful.
It's two manuals, isn't it?
Yes.
But it's a large two manual.
Yes,
a large
and orchestral too.
And orchestral.
Yes. That's,
and I think that was some of the appeal for Bach.
Yes.
Because he was always interested in having a 16-foot bassoon or fagotto on the grate. And he also wanted to have viola da gamba strings.
Yes, there's a viola da gamba on it.
I remember that.
Right, yes.
I have a recording of it.
Oh,
and
really?
I remember the specification and the pictures of the thing.
It's beautiful, isn't it?
It's a unique instrument.
I mean, for me, an organ has to look good, because when it's not sounding, it's a statement.
Yes.
It is real visual art, isn't it? I mean, they
are immensely
incredible. So. And that organ is one of the, well, there's so many, hard to say.
But it was a combination of so many skills and artisans who involved that, not only casting metal and making pipes, making all the structure, the wood structure for the organ, screws, nuts, bolts that were made of iron back then, I guess. Everything is created, and then skins that were a hide that was tanned for the use of leather, for making little pneumatics and hinges and regulators. All these different crafts that were involved and the skills. Then once you've made, there's a skill of making the pipes, knowing which pipes to make and what things should go into the instrument, and then the voicing begins. So it's so many levels.
It is, isn't it?
But the visual part of it,
it's
interesting how they designed facades, cases that were functional but had some kind of architectural integrity.
Yeah.
And they used the golden mean for measurements.
Yes.
That thing that's approximately 3 to 2.
Yeah.
It's based on the proportions of the Parthenon.
Right.
And the exact proportions of that. And the relationship of that was used. And when you look at some of the historical drawings of seeing the cases that are drawn with all of these engineering lines going this way and that way and this way and that way, it forms all kinds of triangles, and it's where things intersect that they know it was right.
That's incredible.
So that visually it made the right statement as well as functional.
Wow. Well, it's been great chatting with you again. Thank you so much, Gordon. I really have enjoyed it.
Well, thank you. You know the only thing I missed today?
What?
Books to Hootabelle.
Books to Hootabelle.
Yes, your dog was here the last time we had a chat.
He sends his love.
Oh, good.
Thank you.
So, thank you so much.